Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Planet You Inherit, Letters to My Grandchildren When Uncertainty's a Sure Thing, by Larry L. Rasmussen, narrated by Kyle Tait. Foreword, Terry Tempest Williams. Letters of Consequence. When Nelson Mandela first came to the United States in the summer of 1990, after being released from serving 27 years in prison, his number one priority was to visit New York City. He wanted to thank the churches for the divestment campaign from South Africa in America. That campaign's beginning lay with graduate students at Union Theological Seminary. Larry Rasmussen was one of those students. During his time as a PhD student at Union, from 1965 to 1968, Larry was part of a group that decided to transfer their personal bank account funds from Chemical Bank, a large New York bank that was making loans to the apartheid government of South Africa, to the new Freedom National Bank on 125th Street in Harlem, an institution that came out of the civil rights movement. The president of the bank was Jackie Robinson. Larry would tell you his transfer, along with a dozen or so students, included a balance of two digits left of the period. That wasn't what mattered. What mattered is that they took a stand, and that stand grew as they talked to other church organizations to follow suit and boycott U.S. banks loaning money to South Africa. Soon, other organizations were joining the anti-apartheid divestment movement, with true momentum arriving when the California Teachers' Pension Fund joined the movement. In Larry Rasmussen's words, "In a victory for us, Union Seminary also withdrew its accounts from Chemical Bank and put their money in Freedom National. And I remember the packed sanctuary at the Riverside Church when Nelson Mandela, released from prison but not yet elected president of a non-apartheid South Africa, mounted the pulpit to thank the churches across the country for the divestment campaign." Rasmussen had been at the Riverside Church before, on April 4, 1967, when Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his landmark speech, "A Time to Break Silence." One can imagine Larry seated in that house of worship with his peers from Union, listening to these words spoken by Reverend King. "I'm in deepest agreement with the aims and work of the organization which has brought us together, clergy and laymen concerned about Vietnam. I found myself in full accord when I read the statement's opening lines. A time comes when silence is betrayal. And some of us who have already begun to break the silence of the night have found that the calling to speak is often a vocation of agony. But we must speak. We religious leaders have chosen to move to the high grounds of a firm dissent based on the mandates of conscience and the reading of history." Larry Rasmussen took those words and placed them inside his soul and acted on them. 10 days after the Riverside Address, he writes, "We all marched with King from Central Park to the United Nations." History reports Dr. King spoke before a crowd of 125,000 people, urging the United Nations to pressure the United States to stop bombing Vietnam. From protesting the Vietnam War to supporting the civil rights movement that led to his own actions of helping to organize the anti-apartheid movement in America as a student at Union, to his own moral merging of social justice with environmental justice, to the intersectionality of human and ecological survival inherent within the climate crisis before us that he so powerfully speaks to now. The moral trajectory of Larry Rasmussen can be traced through these loving letters found in The Planet You Inherit, written to his grandsons, Eduardo and Martin. It is here, in these insightful pages, that Larry Rasmussen says to his grandsons, citing Viktor Frankl, "Being conscious is simply being alive, and being both alive and responsible is the truth of being human." Amen. There are few people in the world I admire more than Larry Rasmussen. He is a peacemaker, a spiritual leader who walks the path led by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Nelson Mandela, men he admired, whom he followed, walked with, and worked for their principles of freedom and justice for all. He speaks the truth from the vantage point of a long, full life, committed to social and ecological justice. Larry has devoted his whole being to an ethical stance toward life. He is a pioneering force in the now burgeoning realm of eco-theology that includes justice for all species and their right to live and flourish on Earth. Whereas environmentalists tended to ignore human injustices in relationship to the injustices to the land, and the social justice movement primarily focused on human needs outside of their interconnectedness with the environment, Larry Rasmussen, as the Reinhold Niebuhr Professor Emeritus of Social Ethics at Union Theological Seminary, brings these two hands of concern together in prayer. This same prayer for a just world can be heard, and most importantly felt, in this deeply moving book, The Planet You Inherit, Letters to My Grandchildren, When Uncertainty's a Sure Thing. The letters are penned to his grandsons, Eduardo and Martin, now children, to be read throughout their lives. Larry and his beloved companion, Nyla, have embraced not only their own children and grandchildren, but all of us for whom they have so generously brought into their loving circle of community, a community of care and joy. Larry Rasmussen, as grandfather to Eduardo and Martin, writes in his letter on October 18, 2020, "What's patently unfair is that you, as Anthropocene kids, did not create the problems you're inheriting, yet you're forced to be responsible for them throughout your lives. The question is not whether you will have to confront climate catastrophe, but how you will respond, individually and collectively." He encourages them to find your vocation, your calling, your great work that will be to remap the world on an altered earth for a different way of life in an uncharted future. He then says, "I suspect you will find yourself saying yes to life in spite of everything." The Planet You Inherit is a rich compendium of information, history, and wisdom. It is not without its tools for retrieving what we may have lost: hope. These letters are for anyone in search of a map that might better illuminate where we are and how we got here. I keep returning to the letter written on February 26, 2021. Rasmussen speaks of essential elements needed to thrive in the Anthropocene. "We'll build cairns," he tells Eduardo and Martin. Cairns are small stone towers that serve as points of reference where the trail doesn't yet exist or is easily lost. "I now look for the cairns that Larry has set forth on this uncertain path we now all share as human beings: cosmology, community, ethics, and ritual." He defines the last cairn as the inner journey, the vital role of cultivating spirituality for life in a new epoch. What we see through these letters written by one of our elders at this moment in time is that the challenges we face are not just political issues or social issues or even environmental issues, but spiritual ones. Larry Rasmussen embodies what a spiritual life in the name of love, family, and community can yield when we choose to be in the service of something larger than ourselves. Ralph Waldo Emerson's saying comes to mind: "The purpose of life is not to be happy. It is to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, to have it make some difference that you have lived and lived well." The Planet You Inherit is more than an epistolary. It is a call to loving action, arm in arm with others, on this beautiful, broken planet we call home. Terry Tempest Williams, Harvard Divinity School, February 28, 2022. Author's note: I knew my grandchildren confronted the harrowing challenge of moving from industrial to ecological civilization, the great transition it's called. Epoch Times. I was ready for that. But my pen was startled to discover a truth that's taken us by stealth. That for the first time ever, humanity's become a geological force. We've slid off the back end of one geological epoch, the Holocene, onto the front end of another, the Anthropocene, the age of the human. Thus we face epoch, E-P-O-C-H times, as well as epic, E-P-I-C times, and a further daunting transition. These transitions are the great work, Thomas Berry, that awaits my grandchildren. Though they were never asked and didn't get a vote, remapping and remaking the world amid uncertainty is their calling, as it is ours. Although their world cannot be ours, and shouldn't be, I wanted to step away from an academic career teaching social ethics and just write love letters. Love letters that face what they face on a changed and changing planet. I'm certain the letters are urgent, not because the kids' grandparents are frail, but because their world is. Epoch Times, January 15, 2018. Dear Eduardo, this is a love letter, but not the usual kind. Of course, your grandma Nyla and I, along with your abuelos in Colombia, match doting grandparents anywhere. Our affection lacks nothing. Yet this is the very first letter in the whole history of love that consciously sends love from grandparents in one geological epoch to a grandchild in another. From the late Holocene to the early Anthropocene. That's weird. It's also important because the Anthropocene is the time of your life, while the Holocene is the time of ours. To us, this language is strange, yet probably not to you if you were reading this as a young adult. Now you're still a preschooler, so I expect you won't read this for many years. Unlike us, you will experience the tumultuous changes that straddle a new geological epoch. Although human history and human experience were our main subjects, Earth science and planetary experience will likely be yours. Our human drama is a chapter in Earth's drama, and Earth's drama is a chapter in the galaxies. We belong to the journey of the universe. I awoke this morning to write of your geological epoch and mine. I suspect you already know from school and your smartwatch that Holocene means the wholly recent epoch, ours, while Anthropocene, yours, means the age of the human, from Anthropos, Greek for human. God only knows why all geologists speak Greek. It's hopelessly nerdy to talk about a graph. What love letter features a science graph? One can follow the line in the graph. From the last 11,000 years to zero, the late Holocene, the variation is less than 1 degree Celsius, 1.7 degrees Fahrenheit, above the baseline, to less than 1 degree below it. This small 2 degree Celsius difference is rare in Earth's history. Look how erratic the line is before it flattens. Earth is normally fickle. Here's the kicker. The grammar of the epoch that has hosted every single human civilization to date, bar none, comes down to climate stability. Uncommon stability, generating a riot of life. And it's coming to an end. It's more than climate, though. The whole natural world is uncommonly reliable in the late Holocene. Friendly, too. By comparison, that tranquility, predictable seasons, made agriculture possible, as well as settled societies and cities. There could be divisions of labor and social stratification, along with domesticated plants and animals, all because people lived in places with dependable habitats. It's not a coincidence that the earliest civilizations all arose at the same time, whether in China, India, Egypt, Persia, or Mexico, courtesy of a friendly Holocene. How important is that to who you are? Our brand of humans, Homo sapiens, has been marching around and making love for 200,000 to 300,000 years. But sapien civilizations have only existed for the past 10,000 to 12,000 years. Since we had big brains, native intelligence, and lots of life experience long before any civilizations arose. Why the delay of a couple hundred thousand years? Why is civilization an exception, even for us? Because settled societies had to wait until the big ice sheets receded to the poles and a long stretch of climate moderation settled in. All settled societies developed within a narrow temperature band. So if the only period as stable as our own is our own, as one climate journalist put it, and climate stability is a prerequisite for organized society, what do we do now when planetary uncertainty is the only sure thing? Grandma Nyla's and my lifetime fall to the far right of this line, where the line heads straight up. That spike is the early Anthropocene epoch. It's where we leave our lives behind, and you begin yours. Did you know that before your generation, no humans of any stripe ever lived on a planet as hot as this one? I cannot tell you what we would give so that you did not live your days on that trajectory. That line, your life, is climate instability, mass uncertainty, and breathtaking extinction. Tragedy crouches there, and I pray that somehow you wring adaptation from distress. A stone sits in my stomach, because I know that Anthropocene citizens who continue Holocene habits doom their children. Still, the world has not stopped being beautiful. You will remember our days on the Red Rock Mesas of New Mexico. This beautiful, broken country of erosional beauty, where rocks tell time differently, and the wing beats of ravens come to us as prayers. You'll remember our adobe-style house, too, and many patio hours sketching with colored chalk or doing a puzzle together. You may also remember dark skies of bright stars, even here in town, and the blue and pink stripes on the horizon at dawn. I guess the Greeks had it right. Their word cosmos means order, those stars in their courses. And it also means beauty, as in cosmetics, though cosmetics is a bit trivial for the life and death of 100 billion galaxies, or for a striped dawn. Cosmos as beauty and order belongs to life, Eduardo. So go Greek and claim the beauty that exists. Let it guide you. Beauty is its own resistance, contending with all that is ugly and chaotic. Alice Walker is my favorite on this. The sentence that gave her most famous novel its title finds Suge saying, "I think it pisses God off if you walk by the color purple in a field somewhere and don't notice it." That's how we should walk, with our step affected by beautiful things like the color purple. Pissing God off isn't a good idea either. If the tumultuous world has not stopped being beautiful, neither has love stopped being love. Even a wounded world is feeding us. Even a wounded world holds us, giving us moments of wonder and joy. That's my latest, most favorite author, Robin Wall Kimmerer. And she's right. If we choose joy over despair and love over hate, it's because Earth offers love and joy daily. In any event, you, Grandma Nyla, and I have precious days together in the great transition that will define every day of your life and the last ones of ours. However many years that takes, but surely your lifetime, may well turn out to be the branching point between calamity and wisdom. Did you know that your birth year, 2015, was decisive? In several ways. it was the warmest on record to that point. In the United States, in the first days of December alone, 1,426 high temperature records were broken when you were 10 months old. That was hardly a shocker, since the year before was the hottest until then. And the five hottest years have been the last 5 years, from the year before your birth on through your 2019 birthday. In May of 2015, when you were but 3 months, carbon dioxide, CO2, exceeded 400 parts per million, ppm, for the first time in all of human history. Half that climb came after 1980, in only half my lifetime. The present 412 ppm is the highest carbon concentration in 3 million years. Even more alarming, its rate of increase is unprecedented in both the historical and geological record. The planet's rising temperature means we're losing ice. The rate of Antarctic ice loss has tripled between 2007 and 2015. Greenland, the second largest ice sheet on our planet, is also melting at record rates. Dramatic sea level rise is baked in. All that melted ice has to go somewhere. Still, the most significant news of your birth year was hardly reported at all. A new geological epoch. For the first time, the planet moved 1 degree Celsius, 1.7 degrees Fahrenheit, above pre-industrial levels, and the same degree above what would have been its natural temperature. We left the Holocene for the Anthropocene. None of us was paying attention, but a geological shift was happening as your mom gave birth. History-making response happened in 2015 as well. On December 12th, 195 nations signed the Paris Agreement on climate change, a political miracle, even when everyone present agreed it was only the first step. To stave off a runaway catastrophe, greenhouse gas emissions must drop to zero by 2050, when you are 35. Since your birth, we've experienced monster storms. Hurricanes Harvey, Irma, Maria, and Jose, and wildfires in both Northern and Southern California. In Barrow, Alaska, the climate monitoring station's algorithms found the warming data so unreal, they simply cleaned the slate, like your Etch-a-Sketch pad. Without algorithms for a normal that far out of range, the temps just disappeared from the computer record. I fear our Holocene ways are similar. Most of us, in effect, clean the slate and carry on as before. We look with alarm at climate system change, and then look away. In the only place it counts, our habits, we are climate change deniers, neither ready to do anything about it, nor truly to live with it. Another 2015 response came earlier, in June. The papal encyclical Laudato Si. It's the single most powerful indictment to date of the modern world gone wrong. Moreover, it challenges what Paris still enshrines, continuing economic growth within the framework of global corporate capitalism. The encyclical speaks of climate change impacts as catastrophe and disaster, while the Paris Accord uses the tepid language of adverse effects. And the Pope dares to say what Paris does not, that the happiness of the rich is subsidized by the suffering of the poor and the earth together. Happiness comes with the debt that privilege exacts day by day, from womb to tomb. As if adding an exclamation point to the papal plea, 17 leading climate scientists said that 2015 was the decisive moment. The window for a rise less than 2 degrees Celsius, 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, was barely open. In a word, it was a last chance for the future we desire. Scientists rarely talked like that, until now. The third turning point all but mentioned you by name. It's Juliana et al. Versus the United States. 21 children and young adults, backed by our Children's Trust, brought suit against the U.S. government, The children's lawsuit argues that the government holds resources such as land and water in trust for its citizens, and should be considered a trustee of the atmosphere as well. How Kids vs. Climate turns out, you will know. It found its prophet in Swedish climate activist Greta Thunberg and the blazing rally of 4 million youths in the global climate strike. However it turns out, I'm clear about another development, an awakening of sorts. We have become aware of the wonder we are. We're part of the journey of the universe. This is both sound science, Eduardo, and your identity. Your origins are stellar. The calcium in your teeth, the iron in your blood, and the gold of a wedding band you might someday wear are all gifts of exploding stars, supernovas. Indeed, every one of the 94 natural elements found on Earth was created in the core of distant stars and then blasted into space, where gravity assembled them into galaxies and solar systems. Did you know that the grace of star death funded your life, and that you were star stuff before you were Earth stuff? It literally takes a universe to raise a child. You, the little brother you tell us is swimming in your mommy's tummy, and all your friends, ancestors, pet turtles, and progeny. The Crow Nation knew this. We love the stars, and the stars love us back. That's the way to sing the song of life. What I most want for you and your baby brother is that you let yourselves be overwhelmed by wonder and lose yourselves in the kaleidoscope of creation. Not to escape this harsh world, but to better inhabit it. Wondering is a way of experiencing truth. Of course, you should follow science fiercely. Tested expertise is indispensable. Yet rational analysis can miss the most essential things of life, which are bonds of love and belonging. And they are most at home in the wonder and awe that lead to knowing deeper and caring more. Wonder sometimes comes in wee packets. I've loved watching you plant tiny carrot seeds and then seeing your delight in the first green pushing through. A carrot grows in Brooklyn. Am I making too much of your seedlings to claim that wonder is the goal of all philosophy and theology? I doubt it. Yet to date, this cosmic wonder is without translation into law or even conventional consciousness. My prayer is that the children's lawsuit, together with the papal encyclical, might join the cosmology of wonder and its intergenerational ethic. My dear child, I must break off for today, though not before a confession. It turns out that Grandma Nyla, I, and our ancestors lived our whole lives by a single fatal premise. We assumed that what was good for us would be good for the world, as Wendell Berry put it. We were wrong. For the rest of my days, I will puzzle how it came to pass on our watch that the Holocene morphed into the Anthropocene, and we left you a diminished planet. How is it that the order of creation's well-being as primary and human well-being as derivative was flipped? How is it that our imprint is now so deep and dangerous that we are not only the ark, but the flood? How is it that we miss the obvious, that it's suicidal to live our lives at the expense of planetary life, and that planetary life is all we have? The fault lies with our powers, I'm pretty sure, and the myths they serve. The myth of human centrality, the myth of our separation from nature, and the myth that we control what we create so as to render history as progress. We've lived them with such ardor that we forgot they were myths. Many live them with grasping determination still, yet none is true. I truly did not sit down to write you a letter like this. I had in mind something lighthearted, as love letters can be, and something adventuresome, like young people opening a door at the back of the closet into a new world. Oh well, next time. I promise more joyful things and some good stories. Grandma Nyla and I send all our love. Te amo, Grandpa. Tender Years, July 8th, 2020. Dear Spud, Martine, before you pillow your head on your second birthday, today, and awaken to your third trip around the sun, I have memories to share. It's good to recall my own tender years as Grandma Nyla and I write in the autumn of our lives, just as you and your brother enter the spring of yours. My entire world at your age, and until high school, was the Berg, Petersburg, Minnesota, a village of 50 hearts on the west branch of the Des Moines River. The river, utterly indifferent to borders, quietly joined the farmlands and riparian woodlands of southern Minnesota to northern Iowa, a bike ride away. My grandpa, your great-great-grandfather, ran the Berg's general store. The store itself is vivid in my memory. Like the general store in many a rural village, it was the one shop with everything. Outside were bags of feed and sometimes bales of hay to tide farm animals over to the next harvests. Inside, stave barrels with scoops and heavy wooden lids. I was 4, 5, and 6 during the war years, when everyone came to the store with ration books to help themselves to sugar, flour, grains, and whatever else the barrels offered. My favorites were the pickle barrel and the tall, wide-mouthed jar with licorice rope. The rest of the store was groceries, meat in a deli-like case, a few clothes and school supplies, ammonia cleaners, work gloves, fishing poles and lures, bike tire tubes, overshoes, and various sundries. Everything a town's sole store was supposed to stock. It doubled as a meeting place. Because this was wartime, conversations invariably turned to word about family members and the fighting forces. My dad had enlisted in the Navy. My grandma, on my mother's side, had a piece of white embroidery with 5 red stars, one for each son in the Army, on the narrow strip of wall between the 2 big kitchen windows. When my Aunt Mabel noted the piece missing, she said, "Mother, where is your patriotism? The war's not over." Grandma, never one for words, turned from the sink to her daughter and said, "My boys are home and safe." No more needed to be said. Grandma's spare speech was typical of the Petersons. Well, the Rasmussens, too. Actually, just about everybody. Kathleen Norris, interviewing folks for Dakota, a spiritual biography, found that typical Midwesterner sentences ran the gamut from one word to 2. Yep. Nope. Pretty good. Not bad. Pretty good and not bad occupied the upper echelons of praise. These people, Norris says, think that you get only so many words in life, and when you use them all, you die. Yet there was always chatter in Granddad's store. I grew up watching neighbors care for one another, with their wartime solidarity and sacrifice, joy and grief all present. Even if, in typical Minnesota fashion, they were low-key and understated, like the grainy photographs of those years. A butcher's shop joined the creamery, where I later landed my first job, scrubbing milk cans for 75 cents an hour. The Lutheran church and the parsonage, the teacherage and the grade school where I was the only boy in my class, Shorty Standard Oil, and a few lanes and houses were all up the hill to the north. That rounded out the Berg, except for Vern Adams's blacksmith shop. The blacksmith is his own story. Vern wandered in other galaxies much of the time. The fact that he toggled between our reality and his own was a curiosity for us, to be sure. But mostly, We love to just watch him hammer iron into submission, with orange, yellow, red, blue, and even purple sparks flying against his gloves, apron, and the kind of drop-down visor welders use. None of the outdoor movies we watched on Tuesday nights matched Vern's Bowels of Hell forge. Time with him could be scary, though. He always had his shotgun near at hand, in case aliens showed up without giving proper notice. He yelled at us, too. "You kids go away and never come back!" But we always did. Until he died, leaving a ramshackle house stuffed floor to ceiling with hoarded goods of no measurable value or meaning, except to him. That was pretty much the Berg, except for my mother's, your great-grandmother's mammoth garden, and Pointer's gravel pit, where we could go swimming and catch frogs until sundown if we had weeded the garden and brought bath and dishwater in from the well. A free-range childhood and the muddy Des Moines were world enough for us. Books other than school books were not part of our lives, so I rarely fell into a beanbag in a corner to read of other kids' adventures. Rather, we grew up outdoors in all four seasons. There was nothing we couldn't do, and few things we didn't try. One time, a big tree fell along the riverbank, and someone sawed its trunk into hunks a foot and a half long. Perfect, we thought, as we set out to create our own raft. With a couple of planks and a rope, we wedged our sturdy ship down the soft bank into the char-brown catfish water, where we were never supposed to swim or wade, because it was home to big snapping turtles. Our weight pushed the raft just below the waterline.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.